As most of you will know, the outcome of the Snowden revelations in June of 2013 and thereafter was that the UN added to what it calls its special procedures mechanism, which is part of the central machinery of the Human Rights Council in the United Nations. It added in 2015 the role of a special rapporteur on the right to privacy. And basically, one of the things that I've started immediately by doing in this new role is questioning why privacy, right? And one of the things that I have tried to get people to think about is that while privacy, of course, is a fundamental human right in its own sake, in its own right, it's also an enabling right. And I came up with this diagram here, which certainly the German lawyers in the room will certainly recognize, and had there been Romanians too, and other people from those jurisdictions, where the right to personality and free unhindered development of personality is one which is recognized in German law, certainly since the census decision of 1983, and in many other legal systems too. In fact, at last count, we calculated that there are about 800 million people around the planet who already have this right clearly articulated in the legal system. And you will notice that the tripod involves privacy as one of the legs, but also has freedom of expression and freedom of information as the other information-related fundamental rights, which together enable individuals to find out who they are and to develop themselves into the people they want to be as part of this free, unhindered right to self-development and development of personality. So Stuart asked me to use this as a progress report. So since last time we met, we had a little bit of history made at the UN in March of this year. For the first time, the United Nations has actually recognized the right to privacy also as an enabling right to the free development of personality. And this was contained in the resolution which the Human Rights Council adopted unanimously on the 23rd of March of this year. And I'd like you to realize to a certain extent what are the questions, or at least a few of the questions that I had to face when I took over this role, because it's no longer the issue of what do you do if you are the data protection authority or the privacy champion for the United Kingdom or Germany or Ireland, and we have many other friends in the room, or indeed Europe. When you look at the world, 194 states, and those don't even count those places like Palestine, Taiwan, etc., who exist, where millions of people live, but where some issues as to the international recognition still exist. So what do you do when you look at the world and realize that what is privacy? Do you have a concept of privacy if you do not have a word for privacy? Just think about it for a minute. How many people out there don't even have a word for privacy? They may have privacy sentiments, they may actually practice privacy rights, but the word privacy isn't that easily translatable. Do the Chinese even have a word for privacy? There's a whole debate about that. How many of the languages in India may have a direct translation for the word privacy? So when you look at this, and in fact, I found out that for a long time now I've been challenging Wittgenstein, who said, unless you have a word for it, you can't think about it, right? Not today, but some other day, Stuart, we should discuss how we've proved Wittgenstein wrong over the past 25 years, because there are billions of people around the planet who believe in privacy, practice privacy, but don't have a word for it.